Good morning, Newgate United Methodist Church. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Rise and shine and give God the glory. For truly, the light of Christ has come and is in our midst. And we thank God for God's presence in our lives and in this worship experience. We give God thanks and praise for your presence and for your commitment and dedication to worshiping your Lord and Savior and gathering in this space so that we can fellowship with like-minded sisters and brothers. As we begin our worship experience, I want to lift up a couple of announcements and opportunities to you and things that you should just be informed of. This week, Pastor So will be attending the Clergy Conference Relationship Committee meeting as a member in order to deliberate on another pastor. I believe that's tomorrow. And so let's be in prayer for Pastor Daniel as he begins to take care of all those annual conference responsibilities and leadership responsibilities to the larger church. We are moving into time of annual conference. As a matter of fact, Pastor So and Miss Bay, conference lay leader, will attend the annual conference held in Waco via Zoom from June the 20th, next Sunday, to June the 22nd, next Tuesday. And so we want to make sure we're in prayer for all of our leadership, the bishop, and all of those lay folks and clergy that will gather. I think some will gather actually at a location in Waco, and then others will gather. The majority of folks will gather via Zoom. Let's be in prayer for all of our conference leadership. We're continuing to look for a Sunday school ministry pastor and piano accompanist, an interpreter for the third service, and a volunteer for the second service. And so we ask that you contact the church office for those who would like to apply. The church will begin church-wide pastoral care visits starting June 24th. So we're asking all class leaders to apply in the church office as well. If you didn't get the opportunity to give your tithes and offerings in the tray, for those of you who are watching via social media, want to invite you to know that we always are accepting offering via physical mail and PayPal through the church's website if you are interested in that. And also want to lift up the opportunity for us to be in prayer for each other. Amen. The scriptures remind us as believers, as children of God, as Christ's church, we should be in prayer for each other, that we should be in intercession for each other. So we want to pray for not only this body, but also all those across the world, the globe, who are suffering from COVID-19 and various other diseases and illnesses and issues in life. I want to pray for those amongst our own membership who have been affected by the illness, and especially for Mr. Kaiser, who is suffering from kidney stone, and Ms. Ojada, who is suffering as well. Want to also give God praise for all of those who have gone through various surgeries in the last couple of months, and those who have had their own medical conditions whose names are not listed here. Let's keep each other lifted up in prayer. We thank God for God's power and healing, God's grace and God's love in all of our lives. We appreciate Ms. Kaufman for the altar flowers today. They add such a beauty and such a light to our experience in worship on this day. As we share in worship, I will invite you to stand to your feet and let us lift up our hearts in song, singing this old hymn that many of us probably learned in some younger stage in our lives, "This Little Light of Mine." Amen. Please be seated in the presence of God and each other. As we look to God's word for guidance in our lives and growth in our spirits, I want to encourage us to look at this book. We've been looking at this book for in this particular passage of scripture for the last few weeks. And so I want to again look to this scripture, Zechariah chapter 4, verses 1 through 14, and pray that you can follow along on the screens, or if you have your own device, that's great to follow along with. Or maybe you're like me, you've got the screens, you've got a device and the Bible. You can never have enough word, but want to definitely encourage us to share in this word today. As we've been looking at this sermon series for the last few weeks entitled, But By My Spirit, But By My Spirit, placing emphasis on the power of God's Holy Spirit in our lives as we celebrate Pentecost, and remember that God's Spirit is the force that leads us, that empowers us, that convicts us, that encourages us, that speaks to us. You might hear sometimes some people mention that God spoke to them, or that they heard from God, or that God answered their prayers. And I just want to encourage you that most of the time those people aren't crazy. Sometimes, depending on who they are, they might be, but most of the time, they aren't crazy. They've really engaged in a relationship with God in such a way, or have been attuned to God's voice in such a way that the Spirit of God, they heard, and the Spirit of God spoke to them. You find in all throughout Scripture how the Spirit of God moved, and it affected and impacted our natural world. This is the beauty of spirituality within itself, is that we can connect with a deeper dimension, a deeper dynamic, a deeper presence, which we call the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in such a way that it impacts our physical lives. And so as we look at this sermon series, But By My Spirit, I just want to lift up the title this morning, The Lampstand, The Lampstand. And there's a couple of places in this scripture that I want you to pay special attention to where it talks about lamps or a lampstand. You might want to go back and read it a couple of times, but I'm going to emphasize this morning the significance of the lampstand. Let's hear these words from the minor prophet Zechariah. Remember, in the Old Testament, you have major prophets and you have minor prophets. Major prophets like Jeremiah or Isaiah or Ezekiel, we hear about all the time. But then we have 12 minor prophets like Zechariah, like Joel. They have shorter books and have seemingly a less significant place, at least historically in our faith tradition. But nonetheless, all of God's word is useful and good for the building and the edifying of God's church. And so this morning, and I'm not sure how long this sermon series will go. I guess as long as God keeps giving me a message and as long as I find meat in the scripture, it might go for a few more weeks. But this sermon series, But By My Spirit, let's look at this word in Zechariah chapter 4, and I'm going to read the entire chapter. It's only 14 verses, so bear with me. I'm reading from the New International Version of the Bible. Hear these words from Zechariah 4, verses 1 through 14. Then the angel who talked with me returned and woke me up. Like someone awakened from sleep, he asked me, "What do you see?" I'm just going to stop right here and just let you know that when you read the prophets have these weird encounters with Jesus and with God in particular, in which they are awakened or enlightened in such a way, and God speaks to them. That's one of the unique traits and characteristics of prophets in the Bible, is that the Lord actually comes to them and speaks to them. or gives them enlightenment, or what we call revelation, revelation in the scripture. And so even in this first verse, we see that this prophet was awakened and God spoke to him. Verse 2 says, he asked me, "What do you see?" I answered, "I see a solid gold lampstand." There's that word, lampstand. A solid gold lampstand with a bowl at the top. And on I see a solid gold lampstand with a bowl at the top and seven lamps on it, with seven channels to the lamps. Also, there are two olive trees by it, one on the right of the bowl and the other on the left. I asked the angel who talked with me, "What are these, my Lord?" Notice this, I mean, this has little to nothing to do with the topic this morning, but notice how when the Lord spoke to Zechariah, Zechariah had questions for the Lord. When I was growing up, they used to say, "Don't question God. You don't question God. You just do what the word says. You do what the preacher preach. You do what your Sunday school teacher tell you to do, and you don't question God." But I think it's good to have inquiry and ask questions of God, especially when there are things, spiritual things, that you don't understand. And I just want to encourage you today that when you don't understand something in the word of God, it's okay to ask your pastor. It's okay to ask a spiritual friend. It's okay to ask your parents or your grandparents. It's okay to ask someone who you think might be more mature in your faith. But it's also important that you ask God for clarity. I mean, this is how we will grow in our faith. Why go through other people to ask what you can ask God about and God give you the answer? Or as my daddy used to say, you can go straight to the horse's mouth and you can get the answer for yourself. It's important to ask God. Ask God. If you don't understand anything about your faith, if you don't understand anything about the scriptures or the Bible, it's okay to ask God about it. The prophet asked the angel who talked with me, verse 4, "What are these, my Lord?" Verse 5, he says, he answered, "Do you not know what these are?" "No, my Lord," I replied. So he said to me, "This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel." Now let us remember that Zerubbabel was the governing leader of the children of Israel during this time. He says, when he says, "This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord Almighty." Verse 7, "What are you, mighty mountain, before Zerubbabel? You will become level ground." He's going to offer balance to the governing. The words that he says through the Spirit of God, he's going to give the governing leader balance through the word, right? Level ground. He's going to give him a place, a strong foundation that's level, that's fair, that's true, that from which he can lead. And so we notice that God's word to the prophets are usually words that will help leaders. That's why prophets were important and even are important in our day. He says also in verse 7, "Then he will bring out the capstone to shouts of God bless it, God bless it." Then the word of the Lord came to me, the hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this temple. His hands will also complete it. Then you will know that the Lord Almighty has sent me to you. Who dares despise the day of small things? Since the seven eyes of the Lord at range throughout the earth will rejoice when they see the chosen capstone in the hand of Zerubbabel. Verse 11, this is really kind of where I want to hang my hat this morning during this sermon. Verse 11 says, "Then I asked the angel, 'What are these two olive trees on the right and on the left of the lampstand?' Again, I asked him, what are these two olive branches beside the two gold pipes that pour out golden oil? He replied, do you not know what these are? No, my Lord, I said. So he said, these are the two who are anointed to serve the Lord of all the earth. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. God, we need clarity. We need understanding. We need freedom to understand your word today. And so, God, we thank you for giving us the beauty of your word and the truth and the wisdom of your word. We thank you for your spirit that is with us. We thank you for how you have gathered us here this morning on this beautiful Sunday, God, and we bless you. We adore you. We honor you. We lift you up, oh God, and we've come with no agenda other than to worship you and to experience you. And so, God, we implore you today to manifest your presence with us. May we feel you and know you with a deeper relationship and a deeper experience and a deeper commitment and devotion. God, we pray, God, that you would rest not only in this building, but in each of our hearts. We all have plans that we've made with for ourselves and for our families. Even as children and youth, God, they have made plans and they have an idea of what they want to do when they grow up. But we need your guidance and wisdom today, oh God. As a husband myself, and let me pray for all of the husbands. God, we need your guidance and wisdom to lead our families. As mothers and wives, we need your guidance and wisdom to lead our families. And so, God, we pray that through the power of your Holy Spirit, that as you speak to us today, that we might gain wisdom and knowledge and understanding as to what we are to do, who we are to listen to, what we should say, which direction we should turn. We surrender our hearts to you. We surrender our wills to you and just pray, oh God, that thy kingdom come, thy will be done in us. As we seek to be your church, as we seek to be who you have called us to be. Now, God, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Oh Lord, you are our strength and our redeemer. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. And in our first week of this sermon series, But By My Spirit, we talked about the significance of the oil in this text. And we look at the role of the oil played out in this scripture, where Zechariah has an encounter with God through an angel, where the Spirit of God, the Lord, speaks directly to Zechariah, who is God's prophet, God's mouthpiece, the one in whom God uses to go to Zerubbabel to help him lead on level ground, as the scripture says it. We talked about the impact that the spiritual has on the physical. We looked at how Zechariah's experience with God impacted the natural world, impacted the way Zerubbabel, the leader of the people, who the one who was supposed to rebuild the temple after it had been destroyed by the Babylonians, after they had been in exile. Zechariah stands as God's mouthpiece, listening and asking questions and speaking to the leadership so that the physical world in which he lived would be impacted. We looked at what it means to have basically what Zechariah experienced was his prayer life informing and impacting his natural and physical life. Have you ever prayed to God about something? Maybe it was a healing, maybe it was your loved one or a family member, and God responded. Maybe God healed. Maybe you prayed for some money that because things were tight around the house and God blessed you. Maybe you prayed about opening a business or starting a business and God blessed you to open a business. Maybe you prayed about a child growing up and God blessed that child. God answered your prayers. We looked at what the oil meant in this scripture. Last week, we looked at what it means to fuel the flame of our devotion and our commitment and our calling. We talked about the significance of the oil in that process and how we all have a calling, how we all have a spiritual gift, and we all have a purpose that God has blessed us with. We all have been endowed and blessed and prepared and chosen by God to do God's work. We mentioned last week that we all have a charge to put our hands to the work of God in our world and fuel the flames so that people may see the light of Christ and give their lives to the salvation and justification and sanctification that Jesus provides. We looked at how significant the flame is. Yes, in a physical and very literal sense, we talked about fire and flames. And I don't think I mentioned this, but many of you know that fire grows when there's oxygen. The more oxygen, the larger the fire. How significant is that when we think about what we need to survive, to breathe, and what a fire needs to breathe? Oxygen is essential in both. We talked about just how important it is to fuel the flame from a figurative or spiritual standpoint in our lives so that we can grow spiritually, but also to fuel the flame in our lives so that people can see the work of God in us. They can see the light of Christ. And today I want us to look at the significance of the lampstand. It is this passage of scripture and in all of scripture, that other scriptures, that we see how significant the lampstand is. The lampstand is a symbol of stability and fortitude and consistency. It is a symbol of firmness and steadfast resolve. When I don't know about you, but before I researched the lampstand, I thought that the lampstand that our Jewish brothers and sisters put in the temple was probably about this big. I just thought it was, you know, no more than about 12 to 24 inches across and maybe 12 to 24 inches high. But the lampstand that we read about in the scripture, in the Old Testament, in Exodus, God actually gives them dimensions for which the size of the lampstand should be. And the lampstand is actually about the size of this pulpit, if not bigger.
The lampstand for our Jewish brothers and sisters. And you do know that Jesus was Jewish, right? Jesus, you do know that Jesus was not a Christian. Raise your hand if you knew that. Okay. Jesus was not a Christian. Jesus was a Jew from Galilee. And so his faith, his origin, his beginning was Judaism. And so he followed the customs and the principle. He followed the law. And that's why we not only, when we read the Holy Bible, we not only look at the New Testament, but we look at the Old Testament, because Jesus's whole life was informed and empowered by the faith tradition from which the Old Testament gives credence. As a matter of fact, our Jewish, you hear a lot the word Torah, the Torah in that our Jewish brothers and sisters use. That is, you know, their book. You have the Torah. Well, the Torah is nothing more than the first five books of the Bible, the Pentateuch, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. That's what the Torah is, and the book of law, as they call it. And those were the books from which Jesus built his entire life on. And Jesus says, even in the New Testament, that I didn't come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. He lays the groundwork for the significance of the Jewish culture. And one of those things were the lampstand. And we hear about the lampstand all throughout Scripture. The first time we see the word lampstand in the Bible is Exodus 25 and 31. And God gives detailed instruction to the people of God about how to build this golden lampstand. One thing about gold is heavy. Gold is heavy. If you've ever bought anything that was fake gold, I don't know about you, but when I was a teenager, I liked jewelry, and so I bought some things that turned green after a while, but when I first bought them, they looked like gold. And it was light as a feather. When I grew up, I was able to actually buy some gold, and that was when I learned that gold is actually is heavy. And even gold is really valuable now. And even in the Old Testament, in Jesus' day, and in Moses' day, gold was a valuable asset, and it was heavy. And so can you imagine a lampstand that's solid gold, that's about the size of this pulpit? Can you imagine how heavy it had to be? Remember, I said the lampstand, it's symbolic of stability, of firmness. Remember, I said the lampstand it's important because of its fortitude, of its consistency, and its steadfast resolve. And in Exodus 25, when God was speaking to the people of God, to Moses, and giving them instruction on how to build the temple and how to build the tabernacle, he talks to them about the specifics of how to create the lampstand. And if you get time this week, just go back and read Exodus 25, and you'll see all of the dynamics in which God gave them and the instructions about building the gold lampstand. It's interesting also to note just how precise God was in explaining how he wanted the lampstand to look. God knew how he wanted the lampstand to look. The lampstand was to be made of pure solid gold, hammered out to the perfect accuracy of God's decree in Exodus 25. The Bible compares the testing of gold with the testing of the church in 1 Peter chapter 1. And verse 7. Remember, gold is like any raw or natural material. It has to be refined. right? The gold that you wear, the gold you have, the gold you husbands, you bought your wives for Mother's Day, their birthday, or your anniversary, that shiny piece of yellow, or maybe it was white gold or whatever it was, it had to be heated up to a certain temperature, hammered out and smooth. It had to be refined so that it could look a certain way. In the scripture, they call this testing or refining, and it talks about that once the people of God is, once we are refined, we will come out as true people of God. Zechariah even mentions it later in his book in the 13th chapter in verses 7 through 9. And Job mentions it in his book in Job 23 and 10. Those who withstand the fire will be purified, as it says in Numbers chapter 31. It was the lamp, see, the lampstand being of pure gold, but refined and made into a beautiful lampstand is symbolic of what God wants to do in our lives. In the temple, remember how last week we also talked about how we talked about the temple of God, and the lampstand was to be placed in the first section within the tabernacle, and that place was called the holy place. And you remember last week we talked about how this is a beautiful building. It's a beautiful sanctuary. And we have the opportunity to gather in this space. And there are people who gather in churches with beautiful buildings all over the world. But we talked about how the true temple of God are the people, right? We talked about the scripture that says, for you are the temple of God. That it's not in the building, it's not in the beauty of this pulpit or the altar or the cross, but rather we are God's temple. We are where God dwells and where God lives. The lampstand was to be placed in the temple. I'm really hoping, and I'm trying to be patient here, but I hope that you're connecting this, that this building is not God's temple. Those pews are not God's temple. Now, the people in this place, you sitting in the pew, sitting next to your family, you are the temple. This scripture tells us that the lampstand, the thing that represents God's spirit, God's power, God's presence, was to be placed inside of the temple. So you'll catch it at lunch. Inside of each and every one of us is a light. There is a lampstand because we are God's temple. I like the way Peter said, I like the way it's said in Hebrews chapter 9 and in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. It says, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, to proclaim the virtues of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. The lamp was to be tended by Aaron. You remember in the Old Testament in Exodus, you had Moses and you had Aaron. Y'all remember that? Moses was the one who was to lead the people into the land of milk and honey, the land of Canaan, and Aaron was the priest, the one who called the people to repentance and to relationship with God. He was God's representative. He was from the priestly place in his tradition and in his custom. And Aaron and his sons in the Old Testament, as this temple, as God gave them instructions on how to build the temple and the tabernacle, it was Aaron's responsibility, and not only Aaron's responsibility, but Aaron and his son's responsibility to make sure that the light never went out on the lampstand. One of the most significant things we should notice from Zechariah 4, and particularly verse 11, is where the lampstand is positioned between the two olive trees. Look at verse 11 again. It says, "Then I asked the angel, 'What are these two olive trees on my right and on my left?'" He asked that question. He says, "What are the two olive trees on my right and on my left of the lampstand?" The angel actually told him that the two olive trees, he goes on to tell him that the two olive trees were the leaders, those anointed people who were to lead and to do the work of God in the world. So the two olive trees represents the people who would do God's work. And the lampstand is positioned. I mean, if the olive tree is here and the olive tree is here, the lampstand is in the middle of the two. So you have two olive trees that represent different people who are anointed by God to do the work of God. And then you have the lampstand in the middle. This means that the lampstand should be central to the leadership of God's people. That the light is the thing that gives us direction and guidance. As a matter of fact, David said it this way in the psalm: "Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my pathway." It's important for us to note that the lampstand and the light of Christ should always be in the middle of everything we do. That's also to say that if how we relate to each other should all be bound by the light of Christ. That how we engage each other, how we talk to each other, how we treat each other should all be informed by the light of Christ or the lampstand. Next week, I think I want to talk about because each light on the lampstand gives a particular and specific virtue. Each light represents a trait, a characteristic of God. And I think I'm going to talk about that next week. But for this morning, the lampstand is central and should be central in the life of God's people. If we're going to be people that God, the people that God calling us to be, if we're going to do what God is commanding us and calling us to do, if we're going to live how God is commanding us to live and serve the way that God commands us to serve and give the way that God tells us to give, we must keep the light of Christ central in our work. That means that everything we do should be guided and directed by God's Spirit and God's presence. This is, if you're a parent, this is why it's so important that you parent in love, that you parent with God in mind, that you talk to your children and you lead your children through the light and the wisdom of God's word. This is why children, if you're a child and you're trying to relate to your parents, this is why it's important that you read the scripture for yourself so that you can know how to relate to your parents. I mean, any relationship, the scriptures give us guidance on how to live and how to love each other and the things that we should do and the things that we shouldn't do. The scriptures give us guidance in these things. I mean, even me as a preacher or a pastor, the scripture gives light and wisdom and revelation on how I should do that. The problem with many of us, if you're anything like me, you've got a hard head. My dad used to hit me on the head and said, "Boy, you got a hard head." As a matter of fact, my dad, I never got many whoopings from my dad. But one thing he loved to do, if I did something that was hard-headed or stubborn or disrespectful, he would thump me on the head. And if you're like me, you have a hard head. Some of you probably don't. But if you're like me and have a hard head, that's one of our biggest problems is we try to do it outside of the light of God's word, outside of the revelation of God's word. We try to parent. We try to be the best husbands and wives we can be outside of God's word and outside of the wisdom of our faith. And we fail and we make mistakes. It is when we get back, when we place the lampstand, the light of Christ central in our lives and how we relate to each other, how we relate to ourselves, how we relate to our children, how we relate to our parents, how we relate to our congregants, how we relate to our pastors, that we are able to accomplish everything that God has set before us to accomplish. One of my favorite Christian songs is a song by Israel and New Breed. I don't know if you know that group, but Israel is a singer and he has this awesome praise team that sings behind him, and they're called New Breed. But this song that says, "Jesus at the center of it all." Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it always has been you, Jesus. Jesus. We must learn that we must keep the lampstand central in our lives. And I'm so grateful because the scripture, actually, if you read throughout the scripture from Exodus to Revelation, if you read from Genesis to Revelation, the lampstand is also symbolic of Jesus. Jesus is really actually the lampstand. Jesus is the one who is. That's right. He's everything, Pastor Kern. He is the lampstand. He is. That's why even David says, "Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my pathway." Now, you might just be thinking the word of God, right? But if you're like the disciple John, who says, "In the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word was with God," then you understand that the word is and represents Jesus Christ. And if your word is a lamp, then Jesus is the lampstand. Jesus should be at the forefront of our minds. In everything we do, everything we say, we should speak with power and authority and compassion through the light of Christ, through the light of Jesus's identity, his personality, his deity. We should recognize that it is because of Jesus that we can do what we do, that we can love how we love, that we can forgive how we forgive, that we can be who we are because of Jesus, because of his light. And in John chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus spoke to his disciples again, and he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Now you might be wondering, what's wrong with walking in darkness? If you've ever woke up in the middle of the night to get yourself a warm cup of milk or maybe a cool cup of water, and you stub your toe on the corner of the bed, or you step on one of your children's toys, then you understand the significance of walking in the light. And in our lives, sometimes we have the propensity to love darkness, to walk in darkness, to like to do what's wrong, to like the wrong things of the world. And what we find is we stub our figurative spiritual toes walking in the darkness of life. But Jesus says, if you want to walk in light and not the darkness, then understand that I am the light of the world. And if Jesus lives in you, then everywhere you go, there is light. Not only is Jesus the lampstand, Jesus is the light. Jesus is the very thing that holds us up, the light, and Jesus is light. Jesus is not only the one who is the foundation from which the light can be shown and seen, but Jesus should be the thing that is also seen. Jesus is the light himself. We should also see from the scriptures that we are the light of Christ as well. Christ's church is the light. New Gate, you are the light of Jesus Christ. Jesus also calls his church the light of the world. In Matthew chapter 5 and 14, not of their own doing, but because Christ is abiding in the church. John chapter 1 verses 4 through 5. A Christian who is shining with the light of Christ will live a godly life. Scripture is overflowing with references that compare and contrast light to darkness. From believer to unbeliever, from right up through the book of Revelation. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, Christ says that the seven lampstands are the seven churches. The churches of Christ are to walk in the light of God. It is in the image of God in which we were made. And therefore, we must show God's image to the world and spread the light of the gospel so that all people will glorify God. There are other other symbolisms in the scripture with regard to the lampstand. It was made of one piece. So there wasn't many pieces. It was just one piece. One whole solid gold lampstand. And this has always been Christ's prayer for the church, that we would be one. And so what you find is, as you look in the Old Testament on how the lampstand was made, it was to be made like an almond tree. So it talks about six branches and how each branch should look like the budding of an almond tree. And so you might be asking, why is it because of almond milk that they said almond tree? No. What's significant to know about an almond tree is that an almond tree usually bears its first fruits. And this is different from many nut trees or fruit trees in general. Almond trees bear their first almonds in February. And towards the end of winter. Isn't that interesting? That God says when you build this lampstand, the thing that gives light, I want you to do it like an almond tree. God wants us to bear fruit, to be witnesses as early as possible. And that's why I'm always trying to compel young people to live into your passion. I accepted my calling to preach when I was 12 years old. I preached my first sermon when I was 12 years of age. It does not matter how old you are right now. Today is the earliest day in which you can give yourself and your life to Christ if you have not already. Tomorrow you'll be one day older than you are today. And so today is a good day for us to rededicate and re-give ourselves to God. And so he tells them to make this solid gold lampstand in with six branches in the shape of an almond tree, because he wants us to bear fruit. And at the top there will be a light on each one. Then there's a main shaft that comes up the middle, and it represents the number seven, and seven in the Bible represents the number of completion. That's why you know on the seventh day God rested, right? It was because he was complete. He had done what he had sought out to do, the number of completion. Which also is symbolic that we are only made complete in Jesus Christ. We may be fragmented by the world, but Jesus makes us complete. We may be particular about our politics, but Jesus makes us complete. We may be disjointed by racism and hatred, but Jesus makes us complete. We may be broken and fragmented by sin, but Jesus makes us complete. We may be splintered by abuse and addiction and unforgiveness, but it is in God that we are made complete. You remember Jesus had many conversations with people, and one in particular, he had a conversation with a young lady who wanted a healing, and Jesus said, he asked her, "Wilt thou be made whole?" Y'all remember that? Wilt thou? In other words, do you want to be made whole? He didn't say, do you want to be healed? He didn't say, do you want to get up and walk? He didn't say, do you want to be forgiven? Jesus said, do you want to be made whole? Now, when I was in school, you had a whole and then you had parts. And when you talk about division, you have a whole, and if you separate it into four parts, you have four separate parts, but if you put them all together, it's one whole. And so if you take one fourth away, you have three fourths left, which means it's just a part of a whole. Jesus asked us, like he asked that person, do you want to be made whole? Do you want to be made complete in your purpose, in your calling, in pursuit of happiness, in pursuit of success? Jesus offers to complete us. We are made complete not because of our jobs, not because of good grades, not because of our education, not because of our wealth, not because of our money or assets or dedication or work ethic. We are made complete because of our faith in Jesus Christ.
And so I've got to sit down, but I just want to say one more thing.
It's not by power. It's not by might. But it's by God's Spirit that we can do what God is calling us to do, that we can accomplish the greatness that God has placed on the inside of us. It's not by power or by might, but God, by God's Spirit, says the Lord. Let us pray. God, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you for the symbolism of the lampstand. We thank you, God, for how you reveal who you are to us each and every day. We thank you, God, for allowing us to come into this sacred space and as your temple, as your people, God, to worship you and to edify you and to grow in our faith, to share with our children and our spouses and our loved ones and church members. God, we thank you for this time. We give you praise, God, for how you always bless us. You always show up. Sometimes, God, you show up at the last minute, but it's always on time. And so, God, we give you praise for the light of Christ in our lives. We give you praise for the light of Christ that's shining here at Newgate Church. Bless us, oh God, as we seek to continue to grow in our faith, as we seek to continue to parent our children and to love our spouses and our neighbors and ourselves and to love you, God. Help us, oh God, to be who you have called us to be. And I just pray a special prayer for anybody in this place or under the sound of my voice, God, who knows that they have greatness on the inside of them, but they don't know how to harness it. They don't know how to pull it out. They don't know how to activate it. I pray that through the power of your Holy Spirit, oh God, that you pull it out of them, that you stir up the gifts on the inside of them, that you activate it, God. That what they have to offer this world might transform this world by the power of your light. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Will you join me in sharing in this ancient and historic prayer? When I play football, I don't see them do this too much anymore. When I play football after every game or practice, we would all kneel down in a circle and the team captain or the coach would stand in the middle and they would join in this prayer and they would say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Again, if you did not get the opportunity to give your tithes and offerings, and place them in the tray. Don't worry. I'm going to put the tray back on the table following our worship experience here. But also note that you can give. You can always send in your tithes and offerings in the physical mail and also go to the church's website and give your tithes and offerings via PayPal. As we share in this time of giving, would you just remain seated? But let's share in this song, Trust and Obey.
You may be seated in the presence of God and each other. Let's thank God and pray over these gifts of tithes and offering. God, we thank you for these gifts, for how you have blessed us with a roof over our head, places to stay. You've blessed us with vehicles and transportation to and fro. You've given us a reasonable portion of health and strength and the ability to move our limbs and to bat our eyes, God. You've blessed us with food on the table and clothes on our backs. God, you have been so good to us. And God, we offer these gifts of tithes and offerings as just a thank you for the ways in which you have blessed us. We thank you, oh God, for how you continue to keep us and how you continue to give us strength and provide for us and sustain us. We thank you for every dollar we have in our bank accounts and 401ks and savings accounts, God. And we count them not a privilege, but a blessing from you, because you tell us that every good and perfect gift comes from above. And so, God, we glorify you. We thank you. We lift you up through these gifts. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I guess that's all. I'm so used to the announcements being towards the end of worship. Will you stand again and let us, as we prepare to leave this place, lift up our hearts in this hymn, "Lead Me, Guide Me, O Lord."
That's my prayer for us today, that God would lead us through God's light, through God's power, through God's love, through God's grace and mercy, that as you go this week, every step will be ordered by the Lord, that every thought, every decision will be guided by the light of Christ in your life. Now, as you go, know that God goes before you to prepare your way, to your left and to your right, to give you hope and direction and guidance, behind you to push you to your place of destiny, purpose, and passion, beneath you to keep you from falling, that God goes above you to keep your mind in perfect peace as you keep your mind stayed on Him. Go now in the name of the Son, the name of the Father, the name of the Holy Spirit. Go in peace. And all God's people said, amen, amen, and amen.